Just wanna be with you. Just wanna be with you. Oh Lord, King of glory, please fill this place. Just wanna be with you. Just wanna be with you. Oh Lord, I just want you. I just want you. I just want you, I just want you. I just want you, I just want you. Nobody else will do. Anybody here love them tonight? I just want you, I just want you.
I just want you,
I just want you.
I just want,
I just want you. I just want you,
I just want you.
Nobody else will do. Come on, I just want you, I just want you.
Just want, just want.
I just want you, I just want you.
Just want, just want.
I just want you, I just want you.
Just want, just want.
Nobody else will do.
Nobody else will do.
Okay, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Valley Kingdom Ministries. It's good to see some familiar faces. And want to invite you to stand. Of course, we are here for the homegoing service of John Prescod. He has lived a full life, and we give God thanks for that. And even though it's always sad to say goodbye to a loved one, there are lots of memories that that individual would have left and provided, and we want to celebrate that. Yeah? And so we'll start with a word of prayer, after which we'd invite the worship team to do a couple songs, and we take it from there. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, this is the day that you have made, and we make the choice to rejoice and to be glad in you, first and foremost, because you are our source, you are our life, you are in you we live and move and have our being. Without you, we are nothing. And so we are grateful and thankful for this opportunity that is called today, to be alive, to be in the land of the living, that we ourselves can make decisions that will impact not just our now, but our eternity. And so, Father, we want to thank you for having kept and preserved each and every one of us. At this point in time, we lift up all the family members, children, spouse, brothers, sisters, aunts, uncles, if they're still alive, nieces, nephews, grandchildren, everybody, Lord. We lift everyone up, as well as friends, well-wishers. And Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to celebrate the life of John Prescod. We commit today's service into your hands. All that would be said and done, may it be done in decency and in order. We give you thanks and praise. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. So we want to invite you to remain standing as the worship team comes. If you know the songs, then feel free to join. Clap a hand, shake a leg. All right? And let's do this for Brother John.
Hallelujah. Good morning, everyone. Blessings to each and every one of you. Hallelujah. I will bless thee, O Lord. I will bless thee, O Lord, with a heart of thanksgiving. I will bless thee, O Lord. I will bless thee, O Lord. I will bless thee, O Lord. Bless thee, O Lord, with my hands lifted up and my mouth filled with praise, with a heart of thanksgiving, I will bless thee, O Lord. So I will bless thee, O Lord. Bless thee, O Lord, with my hands lifted up, with my mouth filled with praise, with a heart of thanksgiving, I will bless thee, O Lord, I will bless thee, O Lord. As long as I live, I will sing praise to my God while I have my being. My meditation of Him shall be sweet. I will be glad. I will be glad. As long as I live, I will sing praise to my God while I have my being. My meditation of Him shall be sweet. I will be glad. I will be glad. So bless thou the Lord, O my soul, praise ye the Lord. Bless thou the Lord, O my soul, praise ye the Lord. Bless thou the Lord, O my soul, praise ye the Lord. Bless thou the Lord, O my soul. Bless thou the Lord, O my soul. Bless thou Lord, oh my soul, praise ye the Lord. Great are you, Lord, you're greatly to be praised, greatly to be praised. Father, you reign, great are you, Lord. You're greatly to be praised, greatly to be praised. Father, you reign, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised, greatly to be praised. Father, you reign, great are you, Lord. Father, you reign, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised, greatly to be praised. Father, you reign.
Hallelujah.
Check one. Okay. God is great, isn't he? Y'all in song, I'm like a convince. God is great, isn't he? Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Hallelujah. I want to invite you to have your seats at this time. Thank you, worship team, for that journey into worship. Okay. It's now 10:31, and right about now, according to your program, we will be having a time of tribute, all right? No eulogy, but we're going to have a time of tribute. So we want to ask a few of you who would have known John in whatever capacity, whether it's family, friend, former colleague, or whatever. We want to give you 2 minutes. How much? 2 minutes, right? So it's now one person taking 10 minutes, right? So if you could get 5 people taking 2 minutes, be good to go. So position yourself if you know you want to be a part of that experience, and you will use the mic on this side to offer your tribute. So make it crisp, short and sweet. Your time starts now.
Good morning to everyone. John was like a husband, a brother, a sister to me in every way. What my son didn't do for me, is what John used to do for me. Any hour I come, John Joe, call Minna. He will help me do everything. Sometimes I say, John, how much? He says, hey, Joe, don't give me no money. All right. When I went to London, I called John. I said, John, you all right? He said, yes. I said, you know, I now come out the plane, and I see a nice pair of shoes for you, and I buy it for you. He said, yes. I don't know what to say. I don't know how to sit them out. I don't know what to say. John was so nice to me. John was so nice. But when he is out, he had no sorrow, no pain. That is all. That's all.
Thank you. Of course, it's okay to express your heartfelt feelings. And so we pray God's comfort for each and every one.
Morning, people.
Morning.
I am John Quinn.
Is John's twin brother, Julian.
And we had a good thing going. But I know he's with the Lord today. Because in our sitting down in the evening, we'd go and chat. All I would tell him, John, make right with the Lord. You know, because I see how he was going. And even when I go in the hospital, I watch at him and say, Twiggy, he ain't gonna last. You understand? And eventually we get the news, he passed away. It hurt me a lot. Now I see him every day. I see him every day, you know. But God is good. God is able to keep him until that day when he shall call his chosen one. So I just want to say, God bless him. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Twin. So that's two down. Three to go.
Good morning to everyone.
Good morning.
I'm here to just say a few words about Johnny. Word cannot express the person that John was to me. I will always remember John, even his wife. They were two good people to me. And when John don't care when you call him, he always there and ready and willing to help you. And everything he talk is about Debbie and this and Debbie and that. Everything is Debbie and. I just want to, you know, thank God for knowing John and his family and everybody. May God continue to bless you and keep you safe.
Amen. Thank you.
Good morning, all. I am one of the nieces of deceased Uncle John. I would have heard a story by my father. I was just telling Debbie Ann that some years ago, Uncle John and his wife Vero, they used to live by my parents in Mova. And recently, my father was telling me that, give me a story about Uncle John. My father's deceased wife's name was Gloria also. And apparently, Uncle John bring a lady in the house, but my father didn't know. And my father's wife's name is Gloria. So this man, whoever he is, come in front my father place and bawling, Gloria, come out. I know you ain't there, Gloria, Gloria. You mean, as if you're talking about, so I asked my father, you know, he said, to make a long story short, John brought a woman in there. And he telling the man, well, my wife's name is Gloria. You can't come for Gloria. That is my wife. You understand? Unknowing to him that it had an ex-Gloria in the house. So, you know, I real crack up with that. But Uncle John was a gem. Anyway, you see John, you see Julian. Is a twin. But he was really, really a gem. I didn't get to see him in his last days. But the last time I saw him was when John and Julian, Cassandra, brought them up in Mover, where I live. You understand? And we had a good time. You understand? Sit down, talk and whatnot. But it is what it is. This is part of life's journey. No, everybody wants to go to heaven, but nobody wants to die. So if you're dying in Christ, you're on your way to heaven. But if you die out of Christ, sad be your portion. All right? But I know you probably had time to make it right with God, and that is important. So as Uncle Julian said, we will see him on that great day. Amen.
Thank you. Amen. So this is number 5.
Good morning to everyone.
Morning, sir.
Well, for the past 20, 25 years, I get to know John. And he was living up Simeon. I never hear John talk nothing out the way. Me and John will stand up. Augustus, you leave people alone. One day everybody will come to their senses. When I was living there, I passed down. I said, John, where are you going? I there. I said, listen to me. You have fig up the hill, you know. You have fig by me. Come and cut fig. He will come up. He will cut my fig. He will cut the fig. He come down. When I see he come for the fig, I just cut the fig. Put it down the road where he was living before he died. Say, John, here is the fig. Very well, say, Gus, John at home, but open the gate and put the fig by the gate, inside the gate. And a couple of days before John died, John turned to me. Every time I see John, I look in by the door. If I see him, hey, Gus, you're going down the road. I say, yes. John turned to me one day. He said, you going to work? I say, yes. He said, all right, continue your work. But just now, I going home. I went home, I told my wife, I said, but wait, John told me, continue with your work, but I going home. I didn't know what John mean until when I hear John die. I couldn't believe that John die. They called me to work yesterday, to come out to work this morning. I said, I have to go in a funeral, a good friend of mine die. That day work that I lose today, that will be 3 days pay that I lose because I will not get back at work until in the next 3 days. But I don't mind. John, may you rest in peace. We will meet one day.
Thank you. Thank you. All right, so we'll make an exception to number 6 again, Ablai. And before you start, you still laughing? All right, we'll talk after.
Want to celebrate Uncle John life because I know I want to celebrate Uncle John life because I know he is in a better place. When I heard that Uncle John was in the hospital, I went on the Wednesday before he died, on the Friday, and I saw Judy, and she told me that, oh, he's not responding. Anyway, we went to the room and I see Uncle John and he responded. He looked at me and then the I say, Uncle John, and he respond. So I get into it right away. I say, Uncle John, I don't know how this all going to unfold. Your life is in the hands of God, but I want you to rededicate your life to God. And he shakes his head, and I say, I'm going to repeat. I'm going to say something. I want you to repeat this first. And the next person say, if you cannot speak, just shake your head. And I get into the sinner's prayer with him. And I say, Lord, whatever is your will, let it be done for Uncle John's life. And when I started, say, Lord, Uncle John gave his life, he gave his soul, his heart, his mind, his spirit. He raised his hand and started to make a noise. And it was like, wow, Lord, into your hands I commit Uncle John. And I went in and I spoke with some other. The nurse, they came in. When the nurse came in, the time was up and they allow us to continue what was going on. And then I go back to Uncle John and I tell Uncle John, I have to leave. No, before he said, you want to sleep. I said, Uncle John, he could have all the sleep. He pulled the sheet over his head. And after he pulled the sheet over his head, Sister Joy told him, you need to take the sheet because you're going to suffocate. He take the sheet and he's put it over his neck. And then I said, Uncle John, I'm going to see you tomorrow. He said, tomorrow, please, God. And so I want to give you God all the praise and all the thanks because I know that Uncle John is in a better place. We who remain, we have to make our life right with Christ. Because the Bible says, absent from the body, present with the Lord, if you accept the Lord as your Savior, that is the only way. And I know that Uncle John is in a better place, but we have to live our life so that when our time comes, that we will be able to say that we are in a better place.
All right. Thank you. So you did a little preaching there, make it a little easy for the preacher, right? All right. So that was number 6. There's a special request for number 7. He gained 2 minutes. 90 seconds. Over to you, sir.
Hallelujah. Good morning, everyone. Well, those of you, some may not know me. But who know me will tell those who don't know me. I grew up, my turn, grew up close to Uncle John. As a matter of fact, they just call him Uncle John. I'm Shadi and Kyle's father. Grew up right up by Tante Nai there. And Uncle John to me was a gem. I remember any time you could have called on Uncle John. If it have water in the pipe or water come by, we will call Uncle John and Uncle John will make sure a blue barrel home by me full. Sometimes I don't even know he fully barrel. Because during the course of the night, while I asleep, he will fully barrel. And in the morning, he will come and say, hello. He used to call me, hello. Hello, hello. I fully barrel, eh? I say, all right, thank you. So on behalf of my children and myself, I want to say condolences to the family. You know, a truly John, I believe, is in heaven. Because I was questioning one of his niece, and she don't even know John was an evangelist. I remember John used to be under Globe Cinema preaching. Anybody know that? John used to have a white shirt, long sleeve white shirt. Always in a long sleeve white shirt and under by Globe. I used to live Carnage before I started to live Simonode. So when I go in the taxi stand, John was there preaching. So I believe he's in heaven. Bless you all.
All right, so let's, okay, y'all hearing? Check, one. Okay, so thanks to all those who would have given tribute. I know that there are others who would have a lot to say. At this point in time, we want to invite you to stand as the worship team comes one more time. We're going to pick up an offering at this time as they do this one song, and then we'll hand straight over to the preacher.
You are my strength. Strength like no other, strength like no other, reaches to me.
You are my strength.
You are no other. Strength like no other. Reaches to me.
You are my hope.
You are my hope. Hope like no other. Hope like no other. Reaches to me.
It's in the fullness.
It's in the fullness of grace. In the power of your name, you lift me up. You lift me up. In the fullness of your grace, in the power of your name, you lift me up. Lift me up. You are my strength. Strength like no other. Strength like no other. Reaches to me.
Reaches to me.
Reaches to me. Reaches to me.
You may be seated. And I'm inviting the preacher to come up one time. And of course, some of you would know that that is my father. So I want to welcome him at this time, Evangelist Leo Allen.
Well, praise the Lord. Nobody heard me. That's right. Everybody's supposed to respond. You know why? The same God created all of us. If any of you here have your eyes under your knees, stand up quickly. And your nostrils, and your ears, and your eyes. So it had to mean all of us have the same God. At least as creator. But all of us may not have him as our personal Lord and Savior. Now that's a grievous part. Now it's a joy and it's a pleasure to speak for a short while to people who are created by God. My belief right now as I stand here is that the Holy Spirit, who has to report to the Godhead, right? He knows that God himself said concerning Jesus that Jesus tasted death for every man. You know what that means? That means that Jesus, or let me start with the Father, who's the one that worked out the plan, the whole plan of salvation and for your journey in life. And so the Holy Spirit has a mandate, because the revelation that Jesus died for every man, or let me say the exact words you will find in Hebrews chapter 2, right, and verse 9. Jesus, through the grace of God, tasted death for every man. And because of that, the Holy Spirit, who in the beginning, after God spoke, he brought into being what God spoke. And God is still speaking. So the Holy Spirit is going to raise you down. Sometimes he takes advantage of the quietness of the night. Sometimes he uses dreams to get home to your heart, to let you know that the only way back to heaven is through Jesus. Why? Because he's the one who paid the price for our sin. Preacher, what you're saying? Well, God can't lie. God said all have sinned and come short of his glory. Preacher, what's that glory you're talking about? That glory was the righteousness of God. Here's a little understanding to grasp that. What you would have read, if you did read, in the beginning, when Adam and Eve were in the garden, and God had a warm style about himself. He would come down in the evening to communicate, but a better word, to have fellowship. By the way, how many of us seated here, I'm talking to living people, can't talk to John? John gone home. Have to talk to who is alive. And Jesus cried out. Hear him. Adam! Adam! And when Adam answered, here's the first thing Adam said. I was afraid. I was afraid. Some of us are seated here and we had the first-hand experience of a dying loved one, especially if it's mother or father, right? And according to the nature of sickness, the first thing hits us, according to how the person is looking, and that's what the devil wants us to hear. He go dead. She gonna die. Now, there is one word that describes sickness and the last enemy itself, which is debt. There's one word to characterize sickness, and sickness has an intent to get you out of this world. And sickness, or debt of itself, has an author. Jesus is the author of life. But the author of debt is the devil. That's why Jesus said, the thief is come not but to steal your life, to kill you. And you know there was an old song, I can't remember who sang it, Killing Me Softly. And that's what the devil does with a lot of people. Today he is mounting up his greatest crusade against young people in particular. Because the scripture teaches the glory of young men is their strength. So the devil's approach is to kill the young people softly, but also swiftly. About 1 month ago, there were two set of killings involving two different areas, but in the same Trinidad and Tobago. In one case, three young guys. In another case, also three young guys. So the devil, his intent is to pass you out. But the great word to look at is the word death. Anytime something goes haywire against your strength and your life, the first word comes up on the screen of your mind is debt. Some of us are seated here, and your loved one, in the person either of your mother, father, or someone that is very close to you, and you're seeing them, and you recognize they are sick, and their sickness is worsening. You know what comes to your mind? Every time you see them, some people help the devil, because the more he go dead or she go die comes out of your mouth, you are helping his story. Because I said a while ago, John 10:10 says, he's a thief. And his stealing right now is against the young people in particular. But he's against all, because every time you find Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, you have escaped the jaws of the devil. The only way to escape is to hear the voice of Jesus. There's only one power that can magnify the voice of Jesus, so that the voice of Jesus will never be drowned out. But we're dealing with God, and since God is not willing that any perish, in other words, any man go to a Christless eternity, in other words, any man, woman, boy, girl goes to a place, that place, where there is no communication, like Jesus in one of his stories, true stories. Yeah, he said, there's a great gulf fixed. You had your chance. You never capitalize on it. Because as I just said there is only one person of the Godhead, the Holy Spirit, who can draw out every whisper, every song, every word that comes from the devil to keep people blinded, and also to stop their ears from hearing. Why? Because faith to trust God comes from Jesus himself. How do I know that? The word of God, God to begin with, cannot lie. And the word of God cannot fall short of the truth. The word is the truth. You have the living word in the person of Jesus himself. The scripture says, in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. I have a mantra. You get to know me, and I get to know you. My mantra goes like this: Jesus is alive. You didn't hear that. But it doesn't change the truth, that truth. Jesus is alive because he alone won the victory over death. And that's why death is our greatest enemy. And it's the norm from the Garden of Eden coming right down through history. It's the norm of the devil to confuse us with the thought that rarely describes himself. Don't forget, John 10:10 says he's come to steal, kill, and destroy. Some of your appearance right now, or you're connected, family connection, and it hurts you when you see your sister's son or your brother or another sister from the same mother's womb. Yes, and you are getting first-hand view that they are estranging themselves, firstly from their family. Yes, and then it begins to hurt you. You know why? Because you are connected to them through blood. Now, since you are connected to them through blood, how much more are you connected to Jesus through blood? So you know the mystery that the devil can't find out yet. How come can this man who is the Son of God come down into the human race? And he did it. Or God did it through a mystery. And the human mind cannot unravel mysteries. Jesus was God's mystery. When the angel came to Mary, he says, in a nutshell, the power of God is going to move upon you. And Mary, there's going to be a holy thing coming out of your womb. And his name will be called Jesus. Every time you read your Bible, observe this thing about that name. You have J-E, and there's a hyphen, all right, between the J-E and S-U-S. J-E is the short form for Jehovah. And S-U-S is for the word salvation. So the angel said to Mary, his name shall be called Jesus, because he shall save his people from their sins. Therefore, the aspect that comes into being for every human being, starting with the Jews first, because he says, I came unto my own, and my own did not receive me. And then God opened the way for us Gentiles. And as he opened the way now, hallelujah, he closed the gap. As a matter of fact, he pronounced a deep, heavy warning to his own people. It says, well, after he used his great apostle servant, Paul, who was called Saul, he said, Paul, I've chosen you to go to the Gentiles because my own people are not responding to my love. John 3:16 is the opening door to both nations, Jews first and then Gentiles. So John 3:16, almost everybody knows John 3:16. God so loved the world. But wait a minute. It will never reach you and I except we understand that it takes every individual to make up the world. So rarely when that simple verse must get home to you, you have to receive it this way. God so loved me that he gave his only begotten son, that if I believe on him, I should not perish, but I should have everlasting life. Having said these few words to this point, it is imperative for me to at least release into your hearing, and by the way, faith cannot come alive in your heart or my heart, except the Spirit of God make the good news known to our spirits or hearts, because he is called the Spirit of the Lord Jesus. One scripture puts it this way, 2 Corinthians 3, verse 17, the Lord is that Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. This moment, in this short time that you are listening to the Word of God, the Spirit of God, and I have no worry. My only worry is to obediently preach the Word. And when I have done that, hey man, immediately, even before I'm finished, the Holy Spirit also has the responsibility to honor obedience that moves out from every heart and every mouth that proclaims the good news. The Holy Spirit takes up that charge from that moment. That's why I said early on, the Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead will always follow you. But the good news is this: God chose you in order to understand how he causes his love to reach you. Mothers in particular will understand it. The pandemic did hit all of us. And some people having lost their jobs and so on, and they have children. But I guarantee you, like I said, since Jesus tasted death for you, even though you have not come yet to know him personally, as you know, husband knows wife, wife knows husband, husband knows his children, mother, same thing. Well, how much more with God? God does that which is good or righteous for you to understand that he loves you. That's John 3:16 in essence. God so loved you that he gave his only begotten son. But what am I really getting to? God will do every good thing even though you don't know him. Right? He is committed, and his son is committed to do nothing less than righteousness unto you. So as a family member, particularly as a mother, because you brought forth those children and you carried them, you are more sensitive than the man who planted the seed in your womb. And sometimes husbands don't know the mother because of having this experience of bringing their children into, glory to God, into the world. They understand the pain involved blood, the pain involved water. My God, that's why you have a water bag. And when that water bag bursts, it's a serious moment. It's time for a new life to show up. So when hunger comes against you, all you have to say, Jesus, see my position. Have mercy on us. No set of big words. Have mercy on us, because I open by saying he tasted death for you. And hear what? Jesus steps in. The Holy Spirit understands the language of your crying, from your crying heart and your mouth. And he provides whoever he knows best. Might be another family member. Oh, hallelujah. Some of you would have known Miss Loretta. No one? There are a lot of people who came from Grenada, who came from South, and they're living up in the hill. Those days was hard, real hard. And Loretta, which was my mother, the parlor looking naked. But for some reason, God used to tell some of these people for what they were going through. Miss Loretta, you could give us some bread or give us a little change. And she never. We never even knew until people who spoke it for themselves. Now, help me to understand why I turned my life to Jesus. In other words, what my mother saw, I reap. Give him thanks, that's right. Children today wouldn't understand that mystery and how it works. Now hear this as I bring you to a landing, because we have to capitalize on time. Listen to this. I'm reading the most fearful weapon the devil uses is death. Hear this coming from Hebrews chapter 2, The same Hebrews 2, hear what it says, from which in verse 9 I trace that God said Jesus will taste death for every man. Hear these words. So we have the target, the enemy called death. When God told Adam, the day you eat thereof of this tree, you shall surely die. And the devil came by and confused the weaker vessel. But the judgment passed on both of them. Because Eve was taken out of Adam. And more than that, God joined them together. I'm reading verse 14. Hear this. Chapter 2. It says, for as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same. That is, Jesus took on fleshly humanity. And that confused the devil, because the devil is still wondering, how could the Son of Man enter into the human race? That was normally, it will only happen the way God said and meant it to happen. A man must know a woman and they come together. But Jesus' birth was not founded on the natural way God had given. The Holy Spirit said to Mary, what's going to come upon you will be the Holy Spirit. Or we call him sometimes the Holy Ghost. I love to call him blessed anointing. Yeah. And the word goes on to say here, he also himself likewise took part of the same human flesh. If you read Philippians 2, you will find a witness to this portion of scripture. But here they part. That true death he might destroy him that had the power of death. Hear this. That is the devil. So the devil has the power of death. And earlier on, John 10:10, I'm just rehearsing it to connect your remembrance. The thief cometh not but for to steal your life, to kill, and to destroy. Who does it? The devil. Who does it? The devil. Who does it? The devil. I went that way for emphasis. For all of us to know, we have an archenemy. And his name, he's called the devil or Satan. Now, so we through the word of God, that's the only way we can know the knowledge of God on the issue of life, which is in Christ, who said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So, Mother, when you, even though you don't know Jesus yet, but he's committed to be good because he's called the good shepherd. Can't help himself. I create you, even though you don't know me personally yet. That don't stop me from showing goodness to you. I am your good shepherd. Well, then tell me, most people who don't even know Jesus personally, much more to know the Father, for Jesus is the way to know the Father. Right? But you know, most people read one book more than any other book, and that's the book of Psalms. You're going through some pressure? The tell you what psalms to read. You see, God in his wisdom knew that a lot of people will come to me through my son when they read the psalms. There's a living connection between the psalmist David and Jesus himself. My last scripture. We are targeting the enemy of fear. Who's going to be next? You and I don't know concerning our immediate families. We don't know. But when they get sick, or through the increase of what is happening in our land, and notice this, innocent children, they do not escape. But it brings pain, especially to mothers who bore those children. Now hear this. My last point. Don't forget, we are targeting the enemy called death. Now hear this. I'm going back to Psalms now. Psalm 56 and verse 3 and 4. Now, just before I read it, I read this. You have to understand who David was as a warrior. But hear this. David killed a bear, killed a lion, and he killed a giant. Most of us know that. Amen? Yes. But do you know that David had fears? And the worst fear to have is the fear that comes from your own lineage, your own family. In one instance, he said, my own familiar friend who used to go up with me to the house of God, he turned his back on me. So David, this man who killed a lion, killed a bear, and he was always a champion where war was concerned. Actually, Solomon, in the sphere of war, he entered a cool, lengthy victory because of his father, David. Now, hear what David says. Psalm 56, 3 and verse 4. Hear what he said. What time I am afraid, I will trust in thee. Hey, mother, father, young girl, no matter what you're going through, no matter how pressing, distressful, right? It's like weeping may endure for a night, but when you take it to the Lord, joy cometh in the morning. Don't give up, don't give up, because everything gonna work out for a good once you show God that you love him. Jesus says, shows us how to love God. He says, those who obey my word, certainly, glory to God, hallelujah. Those are the ones who would be showing that they love me. What time I am afraid, I will trust in thee. How do you develop trust, which is equal to faith, which is equal to confidence in the one who created you? Because remember, none of us could see God. And a good example to help us to understand that is, here it is. Which one of you have ever seen your intestines? Which one of you have ever seen your heart much more at work? And we can go on. All the parts on the inside. Ever see your liver? Can you live without a liver? Can you live without a heart? And we can go on. So we don't have to make a big thing on the point of seeing God. We don't have to make a big point. Those eyes that enable you to see where you're going and step. You know, anytime there is a strong imbalance in your eyes, you step unconscious, you're wondering if, and if you have a guide, even though the guide is helping you, you say, you will ask a question. Are going right? Those eyes have been faithful to see, to do every good thing that God made it, gave it to you, and wants for you to see. So here verse 4. In God. Here's where the difference comes. In God will I praise his word. So the source to knowing God and being in God, like in the New Testament, the scriptures say any man in Christ becomes a new creature. The old life is passed away and all things become new. Let me interject at this point. Some of you are young mothers. The person next to you, even if it's your next of kin, they don't know what you're going through. And you have these children from birth, delivering them into this world. But it's a fearful time you're living in. You see what goes on in schools? I'm sure most of us had a living understanding of the open warfare that goes on with our children. Long time, we used to take the chance to put your head on a block for your child. Can't do that now. Can't do that now. So what am I getting to? Like David, you will have fearful experiences with our children. And there are even parents, especially with the young men. Disobedience have driven them so far. They will bring home money, excuse me, and the Bible says money answereth all things, both good and bad. But what happens is, with tears in your heart and eyes, you will accept the money that might have come from robbery or killing somebody. And you're feeling it in your heart and your life, because what you sow, you will have to reap. So when we agree with our sons in particular to commit things like murder and robbery and so on, it is as if we are directly a part of it. But the fear, that's what we are zeroing in on. The fear of not having food, the fear of not having money to purchase clothes and so on, becomes the targeting weapon of the devil. Thank you. Praise the Lord. How are you going to match up? The fear problem started from the Garden of Eden. The fear problem is increasing. How are you going to break yourself free from fear? What is the answer? The Word of God. How do you know that, preacher? Because hear what it says here. In God will I praise his word. In God I have put my trust. I will not fear what flesh can do unto me. So both the Word of God, why? Because only the Word of God can tell you and I who God is, what he can do, how great he is. And that's why Jesus left us with a book of testimonies that we can trust God, his Father. Because everything that Jesus did and is still doing is on the merit and the basis of the love of the Father who constantly reveals his love through the heart first of his son And now every faithful man who is a child of God, doing even what I am doing now, they are obediently ministering the word. And God has promised any good blessing your eyes touched on in his word, and you just become still and talk to him. Watch God work for you. He can. It is possible. Lastly, hear what the scripture say. Jesus, though we cannot see him, he is the same yesterday, today. Can he hear my prayer today? Even as I'm sitting there? Yes, he can. Hallelujah. And that's why he calls on all men who believes in God. Hallelujah. Through him, he calls on you and I to open our mouths while we believe in our hearts that nothing is impossible with God. So, I close at this point. In a nutshell, this, some years ago, we had a religious sect that used to call themselves Jesus is the answer. We don't know if those of who were connected to them are still in Jesus. But this one thing we know, what they were saying remains the truth. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. I want you to stand with me at this point. Glory to God. Lord, I don't understand the mystery and the working of your word. But we can never disconnect your word from yourself. And it is also written, Lord, that we ought to be at all times looking unto you, because you are the author and finisher of our faith. In essence, you are our faith. So, Papa, sometimes we cannot put words together to form or frame a prayer. But we can consciously say, Jesus, Jesus, have mercy upon me. Lord, you see my son. Lord, you see my daughter. Lord, you know before if any of them are going to be deceived or blinded, and more pressure comes, especially on the mother, if with a daughter there is pregnancy. Especially at around this time, carnival. But Lord, we do the first asking on behalf of everyone present here. Firstly, mothers. Rarely fathers should be first. But my God, the register, the echoing of all the pain hits the mother. The mother is the one who helps the daughter if she fails? Yes, to go with the daughter to the health center. We fathers don't do that. So I pray, Father, that your touchdown, the touchdown of your Holy Spirit, and since you say where two or three are gathered, you are in the midst. Lord, hallelujah, reach this unsaved mother, reach the unsaved father. Yeah, every person here right now are connected to other family members. And because, Lord Jesus, you tasted death for us, I'm boldly calling upon you. Jesus, draw nigh. Their mothers, God, grieving for their sons and daughters. But you have a promise, Lord, you'll turn the hearts of the children back to the parents, and the parents, especially the fathers, back to their sons, because it takes a son to continue, oh Lord God, the procreation policy of heaven. And now, today, Father, make it known to that mother or father or young lady or young man. Make your goodness, in other words, spread your love. That's the only way they would make the choice to come and receive Jesus. Father, thank you for hearing, and I'm assured you would be doing more than we are asking of you right now. So thank you so much. In Jesus' wonderful name, everybody say, okay. I'd like your response, especially the family members, if you come quickly and you gather in front of here, right? And after I prayed for family members in particular, right? Then we're going to commit the body, right, for its burial. Is that all right? Amen. So all the family connection, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. The Lord. These moments, Father, we are bringing God this life, oh Lord God, understanding. Firstly, Lord, where the family members are concerned, loving God. And not only that, loving God, some of us, it takes what is before us to bring us close again to each other. And God permits it. Yes. So at this time, loving Father, here's what. If you all use up the space, long for you all to put hand in hand. Yeah. And let me get in the center there. And if you have to come around, you do come around. Praise the Lord. Right. Can't contact? Come on a little too. Yeah. All right, touch her shoulder or something, right? Praise the Lord. Glory, man. He's alive. Now, Father, again, we give you praise. This is particularly, Lord, for family members. They are connected. They may not feel that way. But, Lord, there's a behavioral pattern that you have given us, exposed in your word. And my God, I pray, Lord, that from this gathering here, Lord, we would find back, oh God, heaven's way for establishing and maintaining, oh God, nearness, family ties. Therefore, first, God, we target with a common faith, even though they are not the ones speaking, but I'm speaking on their behalf. And I pray, loving God, hallelujah, right now, Every disengaging, disconnecting work of the devil be smashed, be brought to naught. Hallelujah. I pray, God, that all these family members of God, hallelujah, will begin to experience a nearness, a closeness. They will ask for one another. They'll ring up one another. Oh, Lord, hallelujah. Grant it, I pray, my God. And you said in your word, you'll do exceedingly abundantly above that which we may ask or think. I sanctify every one of them. Father, because of understanding what sanctification involves. And it is only you by your Spirit can do this, Lord, because it's written, it's not by might, it's not by power, but by your Spirit. Precious anointing, I exalt you. Relay back, because you are seeing what's going on. Hallelujah. I made investment in nothing else but your word. Nothing else attracts you but your word. Therefore, hallelujah, we stay in line with your word. And my God, again, you promise, Lord, to establish in Jesus' name every good thing that amounts to righteousness. Righteousness, it is written, hallelujah. Righteousness exalts a people. And we are talking about a family, Lord. Let your righteousness exalt this family and be extended to those who are witnesses at this moment. And therefore, Father, we command your blessing upon this family. And establish your unity like nobody else can, but the Lord God who created every family. In Jesus' name I pray with thanksgiving, and everybody say, amen. All right, you can let go hands. I'm the last area, don't go back yet. And now, Father, we are committing from the earth, he came. And back to the earth, he goes. Father, therefore, I commit by faith this body, thanking you that we know he's already with you, but the body must be committed to the earth. This I do in Jesus' name. And everybody again, amen. God bless you. All right, you can return to your seat. And where is we getting up there? Okay, we are closing off, okay, because you have to get down to the thing. So the last thing, let me say a short prayer for all of us. Now may your joy, Lord, take over everyone that is present here today. In the wonderful name of Jesus, again, let us all say it together, amen. Now we're going to have a reviewing. And just let it be done in order. This side can stream first. All right. Orderly, the first bench, come around. Yeah, come from her. All right.
Never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. Of God, I love your voice. You have led me through the fire, and in darkness night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. Oh, so my life you have been faithful, and all my song.